And Sketch Show and Podcast is on the air. I am Carlos Gomez, and with us this week we have, listen folks, this is one of the cool things about doing this show and like cyber stalking people on Instagram and doing all this stuff. We'll get to how we met each other here in a second.
Oh God.
But we got Rodrigo Rodgon Gonzalez.
How's it going, everybody?
Welcome, man.
Thank you. Thank you.
Welcome to the show.
Yeah.
And before we get to the story of how we met, let's welcome Charlie B. Williams III.
Oh, me? You want to talk to me? Hello.
I'm here.
Yeah, I
guess we're here. I'm wearing.
Here, we'll talk to you.
I'm wearing merch.
Moiching.
Exclusive merch. Son. I think there's only three of these in the world, or four. But yeah, I'm happy to get my Sketchstone shirt. Welcome, everyone.
Excellent.
I'm glad to be here.
Thank you, sir, for being here.
Yes.
All right. So, I want to see. Well, Jack is probably going to be meeting us here in a little bit. So let's hope that he does make it. He's probably stuck in LA traffic, and you know, when you're a big deal like he is, Jack, get your ass on this show, boy. We don't
pay up, buddy.
Actually, we kind of do. Oh, hey, before I forget, if you're listening live to this show, and you guys have any questions for any of us on the panel, like Rodgon,
especially,
go ahead and use the Sketch Zone hotline. Ba-ba-da-ba-ba-da-ba-be-da-da-da. It's, man, I have to get my sound thing together. Yeah. When Jack is not here, my life falls apart. Charlie, you're my security blanket, but Jack is my base. He keeps me soundly grounded. You see what I did there? Soundly grounded.
There you go.
So Sketch Zone Hotline is 408-753-8248. And if you're one of our friends in, say, Australia, maybe? You can use the international number. Thanks, Charlie. 011-408-753-8248. So now that we got that out of the way, I wanted to welcome Rodgon. I've been following him for a long time, and I love stalking. Yes, I love your artwork.
Thank you.
And okay, so let's go back. I need my
Carlos is like blushing right now.
I'm a little man crushing, whatever.
A little bit. Breathe.
Jack and I were walking through the artist alley at CTN.
I didn't get the go.
And I saw Rodgon and what's your buddy's name? I have his card.
Jerry.
Jerry. Yeah. Let me pull it. What's Jerry's URL? That kid. He's another talented fool. I'm following him on Jerry Dunham Jr.
Mm-hmm.
The art of Jerry Dunham Jr. Yeah. He's another talented fool. Jerry, what's up, kid? But these guys were sitting in the middle of Artist Alley just acting a straight fool. And Charlie, you know I attract this foolishness. So I was walking by, they're acting crazy, and I just stopped and looked, and then they both like stopped and looked at me at the same time, and we just busted out laughing. It was
well, the conversation was what animation students have to do to get into the industry. I mean, you're more than welcome to like make the gestures of what we were doing, but
he was,
let's just say it's really hard for animation students to get in.
So if you listen back to a couple episodes of when I was talking about my experience with anime and penises busting through walls, it's kind of that. They were kind of doing that. I just looked at him like, holy crap, what the hell? Now, what's funny is I still didn't know, like, I've been watching Rod Gunn's YouTube videos, and we'll talk about those in a second, but I've been watching his YouTube videos, and I still didn't put two and two together yet. And then fast forward a couple days. I mean, we kept passing each other in lines. We were going to the same sessions and stuff. And we're like, and all this time, I still didn't really know that he was who he was. Right. And then we go to the Wacom showdown at CTN, which was so much fun. And then Rod Gunn was on there. He was about to get up on stage and he gives me his business card and I look and I was like, oh, you're you, you're you. And he's like, yes, I am me. And now we're friends. We're old time friends now.
Oh, like so forever.
Wow.
You guys are cute.
I know. We are holding hands and stuff. Whatever. Don't judge.
I mean, he was holding my hand. I was trying to get away, but
nice.
I mean, the guy's a big guy, you know.
Look at his head.
Someone changed Rod Gunn to prison bitch. No. Just kidding. So I wanted to touch on a few things because some things happened this week that were
a lot of things happened this week.
There's some really good things and some really bad things. So right. Let's get the bad things out of the way. And this might this might actually not that this is happening to him, but it might be associated to why Jack is a little late today. This is DreamWorks, not TV. Jack works for TV. But DreamWorks Animation, the actual
feature
side, the feature side. They, like a couple months ago, I want to say, they laid off like 200 some odd people, and now they announced that that going into January, they're going to be laying off another 170 people, and a lot of those are artists.
They're going through some optimizations,
as we And if you remember,
save the business model a little bit, you know.
Yeah, if you remember, Comcast went through and bought them. So this is, I'm just throwing things. What the heck? Comcast just bought DreamWorks. Mm-hmm. And this, I mean, this is typical stuff. You come in, you get a new regime, they clean house, and they do things the way that they think is going to be better. So if
just sucks for everyone involved and all the artists and stuff like that. Before it was all suits, corporate production people, people of that nature, as reported. But you know, now it's getting into the creative sections of the company and a lot of artists and stuff. Now, the saving grace, it's not too much of a saving grace. People get laid off. You know, most of those type of artists, they can be pretty nimble, but DreamWorks is one of those places where you kind of go and you're kind of there, you know. But you can, you know, a lot of those feature guys are kind of nomads a little bit. So let's hope that they, like, use their skills because they probably worked at a bunch of different places and pop back in. But it's just a lot of them, though. It's kind of like when Rhythm and Hughes went on, had their layoff and who's the other one up there in Redwood? It was not Warner Brothers, not Disney. Who was it?
Not Pixar.
Was it Pixar?
Redwood City?
Redwood, yeah. They shared it. I went there for an interview for, not Square Enix, but for the Tomb Raider guys. And they share a...
Ubisoft? Yeah. No.
No, they actually share Ubisoft a cafeteria.
Up in Seattle, no.
It's up there in that office park. And they used to be there. PDI. PDI. So PDI, when they close that, Yeah. So whenever you get 150 some odd artists dumped back into the workforce,
yeah,
there's only so many places where they can go, and some people are going to get displaced. Hope some of them, like, kind of think outside the box, maybe going to AAA games or something like that. You know, some will probably teach, some will probably do their own stuff, you know.
Maybe I'm curious.
Yeah.
Like somebody that has the expertise of being in a studio, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. You think that they find it easy to go out and be their own bosses after a while?
Some people
can. Or like to be able to find their own work? Because I mean, if you're so used to working at a studio environment, you know, freelancing and actually making the same amount of living off of that must be really hard.
Yeah, I don't think they're inept, you know. I mean, I come from
a studio. No, obviously not. I mean, they're talented artists.
Yeah, studio background. And the game industry is very volatile, if not more volatile than the film. We call this time of year, you know, the black section of the year, you know, when people get laid off. So usually from November or October to December, usually in the game industry, a lot of studios will cut. They will let people go. And usually when you talk about the game industry, it's changing now, but usually back then they'd be full-time things. So like when those people got cut, it's like, you know, losing your regular job because they weren't like jumping around. So I think people kind of learn to be nomadic and jump around a little bit, and hopefully they can get back on their feet, you know. But studio life is, I think, kind of makes you a little bit more resourceful when it does happen, because it's kind of a big blow, you know. Whereas,
but at the same time, if you're good enough to make it and spend any amount of time at DreamWorks,
right?
It's kind of like, you know. You
take the holiday off and then you regroup.
Yeah. And this is the situation. And this is a situation where a lot of people, you might even see this happen now, where you built these relationships with these coworkers and then you get laid off and you're like, screw it. Now I have time to do this idea all by myself, the way I wanted to.
Yeah.
Are you in? And then you see these smaller animation studios pop.
A lot of studios like that in the game industry happen like that too. They form off of closings and stuff. You know, they're like, yo, let's just go in. I mean, take here in Chicago, Robomoto was like that when EA Chicago closed, you know, and they started doing, and you know, Activision came to, you know, Joshua and Dave Mitchell and was like, yo, you wanna do this? And everybody's like, I guess we need office space, and they just started. And they're still around, you know. That's kind of cool when artists do that. They kind of like turn into Voltron,
right?
Create some new studio. Remember Mike Henry, who was on the show, said that was going to be his option if the art director job where he has out in Germany now didn't go through. He was going to move back to Chicago and open a studio.
Yeah,
because of that layoff he had. You know, it's like interesting. You bring that up.
Yeah. It's exciting. Well, hopefully it'll be exciting stuff, but right now it sucks. Having to go through that thing kind of sucks. Yeah. Who's the other people? There was a Co Aaron is on, and S Carrillo are on. Hi guys.
She pulled that up. Yeah, send me a link. Who is the other studio you're talking about? What are you talking about?
Who were they? God, I can't remember right now. They were doing a presentation at CTN. I think they used to work at Pixar. A couple Asian guys that used to work at, I want to say Pixar, and they started their own studio. Crap. I'll think of it. Okay. and I'll say it.
Anyway. No, the indie studio right now is, you know,
the channels are there. The channels are there. I mean, Raghun, as simple as it is, you're creating content on YouTube on a weekly basis.
Right. No. I mean, I'm just trying to transfer the following that I have on Instagram and then just transfer, if I can transfer even a tenth of those, you know, 26,000 followers that I have on Instagram onto YouTube, and then from
we're gonna do a fact check. Rodgon, Instagram.com/Rodgon, RODGON.
Are you fact checking him right now?
We can't have. Oh, hang on, Rod. Don't go to Rodgon. It's he only has 400 followers. Oh, we gotta go. No. Rodgon, the artist. Yeah, if I can only spell the art is.
Give me a second, guys.
Oh, wow. That, my friend, is how you do you. That's how you do Instagram, son. Charlie, guess.
46.
1,000?
Yes.
It's close.
I wish.
26. 26, almost 27,000.
27. He's right on the money.
That's
nice. Nice.
Yeah.
So how are you making that transition? Are you just linking it every chance you get to push them over?
No, I mean, the whole point of being able to transfer the people that want to see your content onto another platform is to not spam the hell out of it, because then it just seems like you're just bugging them, you know?
Right.
I found that it just let it occur naturally. And when you have a certain amount of followers, and then you just keep on posting little reminders on Facebook or Instagram, like little snippets like, hey guys, if you guys want to check this out, come over here. Most of the people that follow me are very intro level artists, you know? And so they automatically just,
what'd you call me?
Check it out. A newbie. No, I'm just kidding. But all these people, like all these artists that have something to learn from somebody else, as long as you present it to them in a nice and an easy way of going about it, and not just sugarcoating everything to make them feel like it's an amazing, you know, life. I mean, being an artist, especially the way that I go about it, I don't work for, you know, I never worked for an actual studio. And a lot of the times, not until like 2 years ago, I started working for a design firm. So I was going at it by alone. I was just doing freelance and gigs and projects and pretty much anything that would allow me to make money as an artist. And it's paid off for me so far. So I'm trying to give back to the community a little bit. Oh, that's the post from today.
Like that.
So we'll I'll be showing this while we talk about all this stuff. But yeah, I mean, here, like we talk about this on the show all the time, where if you have an idea, if you have a story to tell, if you have some drawings, if you have, like in your case, I listen to you on your YouTube channel because you talk real talk about being an artist, trying to make money, how to stay motivated, all this good stuff. And one of the funny things is, I think it was last week, maybe the week before, I was watching you draw and talk. And so I just followed along with you. Mm-hmm. And I posted that video and that drawing. And I think I got more hits off of that one drawing than I have everything else I've ever done.
What drawing? Let's see. What drawing?
Hang on. Let me see if I can.
Was it on the gram?
Yeah. Slash, what's my name? Coconut.
Coconut Justice.
I had to think of
it. Let's see. There's my puppies and my puppies. This one right here.
Oh, nice. You're following along the same time he was.
Cool. Yeah, he was talking and I was drawing along with him. I did the same drawing. I was like, tra la 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 la. And we can talk about this because this came out. That's enough of that. We got to show you yours. it goes to show you, as an artist, it has never been as easy as it is today to get your work in front of people.
Right.
It definitely isn't.
Look, I was watching someone that I look up to. And I was drawing along with them, and I took that drawing and even the process, put it out there, mm-hmm. and that now we're both creating content. Mm-hmm. I mean, it is so easy. So easy.
Yeah, I just recently went to my old school, the Art Institute. I went to the Art Institute, so I went to one of those for-profit schools.
Yeah, because that's where we come from.
I didn't know anything about the art industry when I decided to go into it. So I just went back to her like maybe 2 weeks ago and gave the kids a talk about, you know, what would be required of them when they graduate from school. And half of them were just like, whoa, we actually have to try outside of our classes? What? We have to do extra work outside of our assignments? Oh my God.
Yeah.
And like their faces were just like, yeah, like they were lit up. Like no one's ever told them that in school. And it really surprised me.
Like, I bet you they told them that. They just don't listen.
Oh, I remember when I went, I didn't hear anything about contracts or anything about how to generate money by myself. Like, everything was like geared towards getting a job.
Yeah.
You know, if you weren't geared towards getting a job, you were kind of screwed. Like, if you didn't get a job at any place or a studio or an animation company or, you know, anything, a marketing firm, whatever, you were kind of like just thrown out to the wolves and you didn't have anything like ready for yourself.
I think that's the story of a lot of colleges, you know, like even if you go to a regular liberal arts college and if you don't particularly go into a degree that's promoting more entrepreneurial type things. I mean, even if you go into a business degree, it's not necessarily going to be, you know, prepared to just like run your own business. It's going to be more like being a cog in a bigger wheel once again. So right. I think that needs to be, you know, probably like revamped across the board, wouldn't you guys say, you know, in terms of like having those other classes, you know, that help you learn. I mean, my father owned his own business for many, many years. He didn't even go to college. So like he became a private investigator and ran a limousine service and ran a full service security firm with, you know, doing everybody from stars to regular medical centers and everything else like that. So like, that's not taught, you know, I saw that firsthand. So I always figured if he could do it, you know, anybody should be able to teach it. And if you have all this wealth of knowledge going to school, can you be surprised what a lot of these guys who did it themselves would have been like if they had one or two classes to like say, yo, this is how you make a business plan. This is how you do a contract. This is what it means.
I mean, yeah, like all the originality and concepts are there in their minds. They just don't know how to get them out. You know, they don't know how to properly set up their own little side of the industry.
But I've always said when it comes to business, you have to be dumb enough to succeed. Because if you overthink it, you'll never do anything. If you're waiting for the perfect time, you're never going to do anything, right? You have to be foolish enough to try. Same way, I mean, and if you picked a creative career, you're foolish enough because you hear of people struggling for money, and I had to make all the sacrifice just to follow my dreams and all this stuff. And there's so many people that are always talking about, to be an artist, I have to make this huge sacrifice, right? Mm-hmm. But no one is, and I know this is a crude way to say it, so, but whatever. You have to be dumb enough to say, screw it, I'm gonna do my own thing. And not overthink it.
You have to be balls out. Like, you have to be ballsy as hell to be able to do that.
Right. Right. You have to. You know, there's a lot of people that we talk about, again, on the show all the time, where we talk about people that say, I want to work for DreamWorks, and I want to work for, you know, Nickelodeon, and I want to work for these big places. But what happens if you don't get there? Number one. Number two, exactly. You know how many people want to work there? Mm-hmm. And then you have to outwork them just to get there. So now you're there. Now you have to outwork people to stay there. Mm-hmm. And if you have your own story, if you have your own thing, your own ideas to work on, their idea takes precedence because they're the one that are paying you to do their stuff.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I mean, it's not often that you do get to work on your own thing as a freelance artist as is. I mean, you're creating the content for people, but it's everybody else's idea, not necessarily yours.
Mm-hmm. Right. And I'm not saying don't go for the big thing and go for it, kill it, like go do it. But always remember, you should save a little of gas in the tank for your stuff. Mm-hmm. Because it's tough to give everything to someone. And I'm talking from experience, I guess I'm going through,
I can vouch for that too.
As Carrillo said, he's pointing at himself. He said, dummy, LOL, but figuring it out. You know, I worked on all these pretty cool projects, and, you know, I worked on Tron, and I worked on Tangled, and I worked on Tom Cruise, and I worked on all these big projects. But at the end of the day, I had to give everything back to them, and I don't have anything for myself to show. And that's why I started Robots and Aliens, and that's why I started the show, and that's why I started all this stuff, because I wanted to have something that was mine. I want to work as hard as I do for something that I get to keep. What do you think, Raghun?
Well, I mean, yeah, I completely agree. When you work 9 to 5 and you have to design stuff like I do every single day for some other people, like sometimes I only get these little doodles, you know, I get like 15 minutes a day to draw something for myself. Yeah. I mean, it's heartbreaking that I can't spend all day doing it, but at least I try to get a little bit of my own creativity out, you know, and show the world a little bit of me instead of all the stuff that I'm creating for somebody else.
I'm still waiting to see a picture of a banshee.
I never got a picture of it.
No?
No, I didn't get the picture of the final thing. They never sent it to me.
So at the Wacom showdown?
Yeah.
What they did is they had four people up on stage, and then they had, what was it, 10 minutes?
Mm-hmm. It was a 10-minute like quick draw competition, and they had a 3-word generator for mythical creatures in the Harry Potter world, supposedly. So for mine, it was a banshee, a dancing banshee or something like that. And then okay. I had no idea what a banshee was. So I'm just yelling like, what's a banshee? What's a banshee? And everybody's about
and to they're start, like, and you I'm can like, use oh, your shit. Phone to look it up. He's like, but I'm recording on my phone.
So you see all the like the Wacom people run. They're like running towards me, and they're like trying to like bust their phone out and show me. And I'm like, oh, cool. All right. Okay. That's a banshee. All right. So I just drew one twerking.
Nice. In the Harry Potter world.
And then I think my friend Carly is the one that beat me that round. And then her drawing was just hilarious. Like she does She's this hungry. Really cool webcomic style of look. And it just came out awesome.
What's I have a Co-Aaron. Is that right? Am I saying that right? Co-Aaron?
Carly
not Carly. I have Carly. It's Carly Mulder. Yeah, if you're looking for some really funny stuff, Carly, K-A-R-L-I, CarlyCartoons.com. But no,
she likes front butts.
she does like front butts. She kept saying,
"Excuse me."
If you look at just like it sounds, man.
Exactly like it sounds. Instead of a butt in the back, it was in the front. Front butt, dude. Her drawings had everyone cracking up. Just
that Sasquatch she drew.
Oh god, Sasquatch was hilarious. We're gonna have to have her on the show too. Get you guys on together. But no, Co-Aaron, I hope I'm saying that right. She said, "Sorry, I had your phone." LOL. There was a group of. It was you, me, Carly, that one kid whose name I can't remember, Jerry. And I don't know if I'm saying her name right.
The young kid that got in the competition too.
Yeah, there was him.
I just met him that day, so I don't remember his name. But he was really good too. Like, yeah. He was just like an 18-year-old kid that just made it to the finals of a competition with like 400 people, like pros and everything. Just
killed it.
Just being a savage.
Yeah. Yeah. He just goes up there as like the youngling, you know? And it's like he's going up against like all these comic book and animation pros. I was like,
that's who it is. I have your business card, Aileen.
Oh, Aileen.
Aileen?
Well, Aileen was the little Asian girl.
Yeah. See, that's her right there.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's her. She's the one that had your phone, and she's on.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
She's on the chat right now.
Is she?
Yeah. She said, sorry, I had your phone, LOL. That's why you couldn't look up what a banshee was. Because I think you had handed your phone over to her, and she was recording it for you.
Yeah. And unfortunately, at the end of nothing showed because it was too bright. So it just looked like a blank screen throughout the whole video.
That's nice.
So I was just like, it just looked like I was just frantically writing on a Cintiq with nothing going on.
That's funny.
How do you see the chat?
It's in, I sent the.
Oh, cool.
You got it? Okay, cool.
Yeah.
All right, cool. So I wanted to talk about some stuff technology wise, because if you look through your your Instagram, you have a lot of, sketchbooks, like sketchbook drawings.
Right.
So there's pencils and all that good stuff. Have you used Procreate? Do you even have a iPad or anything like that?
I have a Cintiq Companion.
Oh, cool.
I use that once in a while.
Yeah.
It was really interesting for me to find out that whenever I post a drawing that I just do in ballpoint pen, I get about like 1,000 likes on Instagram. When I post something that's finished and rendered and awesome and pretty and amazing, that's digital, I get like 100.
Really?
It's weird. It just makes my heart break. It's ridiculous. Like the amount of likes that I like, you get a lot more with just a simple than you would on a finished illustration. It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Like it breaks my heart every time because I'm like, here, world, check art. This is like, what I can do. And then nothing.
They're like, we're good.
You're like, yeah, can you just draw that like, you know, little character again? Can you draw the dinosaur? Yeah.
They're like, but scan in what you drew on your napkin at lunch. We're really like
pretty much. People like that more. And at that point I just stopped carrying my companion to work. And whenever I do need to do work, I just work in my home.
Fine, this is what you want?
Pretty much. Like the first couple times that happened, I was like, come on, come on. There's like no motivation. But I use Sketchbook Pro for the most part, followed by Manga Studio. And then I like this other one called Mischief.
Yeah. Ooh, we've talked about that on the show.
Yeah. It's super cheap. It was like $15 for a licensed version.
Yeah.
And just having the ability to have an infinite canvas is amazing.
Yeah. Especially when you're brainstorming.
Yeah.
We've tested it on the show before, right?
You don't have to worry about running out of room, you zoom way in, zoom way out.
And all the brush tools work pretty well too, so you can just get like watercolor effects and stuff like that as well. Yeah. And they're vector for like, so it's like the best of both worlds.
Yeah.
Close was we did a demo of that, didn't we?
I think so.
I remember zooming in.
Yeah, I've been on the Mischief bandwagon for a while now.
I think Steven Silver is the one that recommended it to me.
Yeah.
I just downloaded it on the spot.
Yeah. I mean,
it's a tiny program too.
Yeah. Yeah, it's super simple, super cool. Infinite canvas. That's it.
It's great. And
one of the cool things that I like is when you can draw something real quick and then set a bookmark and then go and zoom in, zoom out, go somewhere else and set another bookmark. So when you're starting to get the flow of something, you can set these bookmarks and then just go, and it moves you back and forth throughout the the canvas to see the different parts that you have designed. Yeah,
and then whenever you want to save, just kind of crop it and then select that area, boom, save that area. And then you can save it at any resolution you want. And so it's just really good for just like doodling around. It doesn't have the precision that Photoshop or Manga Studio has, but I mean, for a super cheap program that you want to just sketch on your iPad or you know, your tablet, you can't beat that.
But that's one of the things when it comes to working in Mischief and you're trying to get a rough idea down, people have a tendency to go in and start finalizing some of the line work and the character's not even finished, right?
Right.
So that's one of the other things that I do like about it. You can get the basic shape of the different characters down and then you can save that out, finish it in Photoshop. But kind of like you just got done saying, if you have, if you post something that's finished, you're not getting as much love as if you're putting in the work in progress.
Yeah, at least that's been the case for me. And I've been also Facebook stalking, like Instagram stalking other artists just to see how their, you know, progress is in that same, you know, type of scenario. And for the most part, it's the same thing. It's if they post work in progress pictures, they get a lot more traffic. But then in the final drawing, they're like, okay, we saw everything. We don't want to see this anymore. Okay, thank you, bye.
Is it because people like to follow, similar to what like Carlos did the other day, like maybe they like to look at your construction lines or something? Like, I'm trying to figure out what would be as appealing. Does the piece look more meatier?
Oh. Well,
I don't know if meatier is like the word to use. Like, sometimes it loses its like luster to some people when like you start coloring it in and stuff like that. I don't know.
I personally think that it's because people can appeal to it more. If you show them a sketch, it's something that they can get to. They can actually recreate that if they wanted to.
Right.
But if you show them a finished piece, they're probably like, oh, okay, well, this is really cool, but I can't do this.
Right.
But on the other hand, you show them a sketch, you show them like a little bit of progression at a time, they start seeing that you're actually human as opposed to just being able to put your hand on the paper and then poof, you know, instant awesomeness.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I know. Let's see. Eileen says people enjoy seeing the process because you feel like they can understand what the artist was thinking. Exactly. Yeah. And I think not only that, but being able to see the process that the person is going through to get to that final thing makes you think that you can also do it.
I can see that. Yeah.
You know, I admit it. I open up Procreate. I open up Mischief and I'll open up Instagram.com/RodGonTheArtist. I recreate all his stuff. And let me tell you, I do like looking at the construction drawing better because I can get those shapes down. Right. And if I recreate your stuff, it makes my stuff accidentally better.
No, I actually encourage people to do that. I get a lot of messages almost on a daily basis on how do I get better? How do I improve drawing? Because once again, most of my audience is very young artists.
Yeah.
So like what I suggest to them is find a couple artists that you like, because this is how I learned. Find a couple artists that you like and then just copy everything you can from them. Obviously, don't take credit for it.
Right.
You know, this is just like an educational thing, but copy as much as you can until you can get at least a tenth of what that person like recreated. And then just subconsciously, it's going to go into your own style. And once you have so many artists under your own mental library, that's how you develop your own style. Because you're going to take what you like from each one of them and then just put it all together, and that's going to be the big mush that's your own style.
Right.
That's true.
Right. Right.
So how did you develop your style? Because even here in the chat room, Carrillo goes, great style, right? And you do have a really cool, unique style. And he just said, totally agree. People see a million images a day. I think they get a kick out of seeing making of more than anything.
Behind the scenes, people do like that. I love those type of things. So yeah, keep going.
But when did you know that you were going to be a creative?
I started really late. I came out of high
school last week.
No, essentially, after high school, I had two options. I had the option of going into law or going into something else that didn't bore the hell out of me. So I remember walking into the art institutes, and then I was just talking to the recruiter, and I always carried like a little tiny, like lined sketchbook. It wasn't even a sketchbook, it was just a notebook. And I had doodles that looked like 10-year-olds drew it, right? So I just walked in. I was like, hey, what do you guys do here? Showed him the the notebook. He's like, oh my God, you're amazing. You're great. Oh, you should go into animation. I'm like, oh no, I want to do the cartoons. I want to go into graphic design. They're like, no, that's animation. And I was like, yeah, that's the one. I'll do that. And sounds then great. By the end of the day, I was signed up.
Wow.
The first day of school was when I realized I made a big, big mistake with the signing up. Wow. So I remember going, and I went to orientation, and I expected everybody to be at my level because, my ego is so big that I assumed that everybody was at my level.
Yeah.
Well, I go around just talking to the people on the tables, that are sitting there waiting to, for everything to start. And I approach one guy, and I'm like, oh man, can I see your sketchbook? And then he shows me, and it's this amazing stuff. It's like just girls and cars and monsters. And I'm like, oh, do you graduate this quarter? Oh man, you're awesome. You're going to get a job anywhere you want. He's like, oh no, I just started. I'm in orientation.
Oh.
And I was like, oh, okay. It's like a one of a kind. This guy's just going to be like the top dog of the whole thing. It's all good. It's all good. Wow. So I go up to the next person and I'm like, hey man, let me see your sketchbook. I see it and it's the same. It's like super cool drawings. And I'm like, oh no. Like it starts to sink in. I was like,
no.
And then
did you feel at that moment that maybe you bought into like the sales pitch?
Dude, every emotion you could possibly think of, like getting dumped, getting a divorce, losing a family member, all those feelings just came at the same time. Like, blah! Like, my stomach was just like on the bottom, like of my body. And I was just like, oh. And then he asks to see my sketchbook. I grabbed my little notebook and I ran out of the room. I was like, hell no.
You're like, not doing this.
And then I just started asking everybody, like, when did you guys start drawing? And then there was, like, stories. Like, I started when I was 3. I started when I was 5. I started when I was in my mom's womb. Come on. It was like, dude. Like,
if you look inside my mom's stomach, there's graffiti that I put in there.
Yeah, pretty much. So, I mean, I started when
there's
I was about 18.
In my mother's womb.
Who did you get this? So I started when I was about 18, but I mean, I almost dropped out like 6 times. If it wasn't for like some encouragement from some other people and like, I would have just dropped out of school. The good thing is that I'm a stubborn as hell person and I'm very competitive. So whenever I see somebody that's better than me, if it's attainable, I'll just do whatever needs to be done to get to that point.
Yeah.
Exactly. So that's what happened. I would just I don't know if you guys remember Borders, the bookstore.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Remember they had like those huge sketchbooks that were like 200 pages?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I would fill one of those up a week. Just
a week?
Every week, just copying other artists. Mm. Like just, I mean, you can only draw out of your mind so much when you start because you don't have anything in your mind to reference. So I figured if I just copy everything that I see from everybody else, mm-hmm. eventually something will stick, right?
Right.
And I mean, after like maybe like three or four of those, I was actually able to draw something. You know, when I kept on doing that process for like the next 10, like 2 years, I was, you know, fairly decent. I was no longer the bottom of the barrel. And then that gave me enough drive to actually finish. So, and it wasn't until way after graduating that I actually got to the point where I can say I have a style.
Right.
And you know, people recognize my drawings for mine.
Right.
But that's the same process that I recommend everybody. Because that's how I learned. And I mean,
get super jealous and then get super driven. And then,
don't give up just because somebody else is better than you.
I used to do that when I was younger. You know, you watch the PBS kid watching Mark Kistler learn how to draw, you know, where you watch him and you copy the other person, you copy the other person on the screen, or you copy stuff out of comic books, you know. Then I would get mad because Wolverine looked a little lopsided. I'd get pissed and like throw a tantrum and then get in trouble for getting mad instead of trying to get, you know, get my sketchbook taken away. my parents are firm believer of taking something away if you got mad because something you were doing, you know. There's no reason to sit there and be mad or crying or anything like that, you know. So I would get stuff taken away until it. I think that's what when you learn how to just can't figure it out. Let's try something else. Can't figure it out. Let's try it a different way. I think it helps me every day at work. Mm-hmm. Don't need to get mad. Let's just figure out a different way of doing it. It's not a big deal.
Yeah, as an artist, you have to get used to rejection. Like for rejection, you know, even like that's like the biggest thing that people don't get taught. Like the first time that you get critiqued and people tell you your stuff is shit. Mm-hmm. Like, dude, like, what do you do? Like, you either break down and you're like, I hate art. I'm never touching this again. Or you kind of man up or grow up in this case or anything. Yeah. And then just like go and do something better.
That's it.
I taught at college level for 5 years. So like I would have to do critiques and my version of critiques were always a little harsher than other teachers because it had a little bit of humor in it, a little bit of like sarcasm, but every bit of truth, you know? And I'm like, you know, how long do you take to work on this? Like seriously, like how long did this take you? They'd be like, you know, 10 hours. I'm like, 10 hours my ass. How long did it really take you? Was that like 10 hours that, you know, subtract, you know, 9 before class, you know? But like, or when you have the really good artists and they know their stuff is decent, and then all of a sudden they get surprised because you're actually getting critiqued, or you have the people that want to defend their artwork. It's a lot of, I think more people should like critique art, you know? I think there should be portfolio reviews for art school.
Well, I think they
across the board.
You know? A lot of the times the schools just sugarcoat everything. You know, they don't want the students to feel bad or, you know.
They're scared for that dropout.
Yeah, so, I mean, they don't give them honest reviews. They just give them, like, the babying approach. Like, oh, you're not bad, but, I mean, you could improve.
That's why we're here.
Yeah, and instead of telling them, dude, you either, like, go start drawing better or you're not going to make it.
Right.
Yeah.
Which is probably, like, advice that would actually help them.
Which is no excuse because drawing is a learned thing. You know, like you can learn how to draw if you set your mind to it. Like any of you guys have taken a life drawing class of any sort and like you've started, you've done, even if you went to for-profit school like we did and quarters are usually like 3 months long, you draw on life drawing twice a week for 3 months and you look at when you start and when you end, you know, there's a difference, you know, if you've taken the class seriously, which is always cool. You know, that's one of the cool things I do like about the school we went to. They gave us pens. We weren't allowed to use pencils, you know.
What school did you guys go to?
We went to AI.
AI in Schaumburg, Illinois.
Ooh, AI alumni.
That's right, kid. I've been to the AI in San Diego.
How was that?
Yeah.
It was tiny compared to the one in LA.
Yeah.
Oh, there's one in LA. It's bigger. Yeah. I can see that one being pretty big. Yeah, but I mean, they gave you like ballpoint pens though, like, you know.
Yeah, they're like, don't bring pencils to class.
Pencils, which I thought was
how we do this.
To this day, I still think that was kind of cool.
Yeah.
Whoever thought of that idea, like, you can't erase, because that's like the one thing people do. Oh, that line's not straight enough. Oh, you know, they spend most of the time erasing, destroying sketchbooks.
So Eileen goes, caricatures is great for rejection. That's so true.
I worked doing caricatures with Eileen at the zoo for a little while, but then I've been doing it since 2004. Actually, no, since 2003 when I was in school, I started working doing caricatures.
Really?
And she's right. It was soul-crushing. Like, you'd get somebody that didn't like your drawing and they're not afraid to go, it sucks.
What are you thinking?
I don't want it. Can I get that guy to draw my stuff? And you're like, okay, yeah, sure. All right, I thought it looked pretty. Okay. Eventually, after a while, your soul dies. It like shrivels up because of so much, you know, bad stuff. So and nice. People that come up to you and go, hey, I don't like that drawing. You're like, okay, cool. How are you going to pay? How are you going to pay? Oh, you don't want it? Okay, cool. Do you want a frame with it? You know, just kind of like block it out and then just push it onto them anyways. You stop caring. So it helps whenever you go into with actual clients and they tell you, oh, I don't like your stuff. And you're like, okay, cool. You can just send me the payment. It's all good.
Right.
And then just make it really weird for them.
Until they'd be like, oh, well, let's do some changes. Oh, well, we read our last revision.
Says pretty much
the contract. Sorry.
Yeah. Those are tough. I went Inktober last year. I've said this. Inktober last year, I did caricatures and people were asking, oh, can you do me next? Can you do me next? And I had some people that were like, yeah, there was this one girl. She's like, oh man, I want to have, you made me sexy. I want to have sex with myself. And I was like, wow, I wasn't even impressed with that drawing at all. But if you like it, cool. And then there was one. She was trying to be nice. She goes, how do you feel about this drawing? I was like, I know what that means. I know what that means. I'm not good at drawing girls yet. How do you feel about that? I was like, don't. Yeah,
that motherly type of like. So.
Yeah. Are you happy with yourself that you wasted that much time to make that?
Yeah. How could you approach the situation better in the future? That's harsh. Who told you that?
But that leads us to one of the things that I wanted to talk about that happened this week. yeah, Eileen, exactly. Just think next drawing. Just think, okay, next drawing. One of the cool things that came out in Procreate had a pretty nice update right? this week. Yeah. And one of the cool things that they did was they added the ability to live stream while you're drawing.
Have you tried this yet?
I did.
So who are they using to stream? Is it their own stuff or they?
They're using, I almost went straight geek. Okay. So an API is is the way that you can use software, right? Is the way that you communicate to a software.
Yeah, turn the programming side off when we have this.
I know. I almost went for it and I was like, wait a minute, wrong crowd. So there's an API, there's a live streaming API that's basically used by someone like Procreate and There's this other website called Mob Crush.
Yep.
Mob Crush is a lot like, why can't I think of it right now? Twitch. I just about said it.
Twitch.
Twitch. Thank you. It's just like Twitch. So they use this API for the streaming, stuff. So Procreate then connects to, both of those, Mobcrush and, Periscope. And so, I had started a Scribble, and then I updated the app, and then I was about to ink it, and I was like, well, let me just try that. So I went and I went live on Periscope and I started inking this drawing, and I got like 15 people watching and stuff, and so everyone. Yeah, it was pretty cool. And what was cool was while that was happening, Dave Atzi was watching, and I was like, hey, Dave, la, 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 interacting with them. And I almost went on a tangent. The tangent is, while you're drawing, you can't see if people are texting you or whatever. So if they have questions for you, you can't see, because all you see is the app and your face in the corner. Yeah. What I ended up doing was had my phone logged in as well, and I was trying to see if anyone was interacting that way, but it was really weird. That's the only part that's, but I don't know how you would fix that. Cause if you have a chat, room on showing while you're, in the app, it's going to get in the way of your drawing. But anyway, so I'm trying to figure out, how to possibly, do a live stream and stream it to, Periscope, but then also maybe having YouTube also feed it to YouTube to make it available on YouTube as well, and helping, just hang out. Just yesterday I was getting some work done, and, if you guys haven't heard of him, his name is Chris Georginas, and he's at Keyframer. He's been big in Flash animation since back in the day. And so he went live streaming, and he was like, well, I was going to be working on this, so I just decided to live stream anyway. And he hooked me. I was sitting there with him for an hour. It was me and him for for a while. Really? Yeah. And I had met him before in real life and stuff. So we know of each other. We were just sitting there, and I was watching him drawing as I was getting some work done. So I was going to start taking a look at that raw gun later. We can talk, maybe, sure. A little collab action. I know we're both trying to grow our audiences. So anyway, that's one of the cool things that happened this week, was that update.
So is Procreate only an iPad thing?
It's iPad, and I believe...
Is it Android?
I believe so.
I'll have to look into that. I don't think I always thought it was just an iPad thing.
Let me see. We can take a look real quick. Anyway, it might just be for iPad. If that's the case,
because I keep on seeing people using it for recording their drawings and stuff like that, but I never really like have done anything with it.
I'll tell you what, we'll get those 26,700 followers to start paying attention to you on YouTube, so then that way we can get you up there. You start making those ad revenues, and then we get you an iPad. And then with an iPad, you see where we're going with this? All right, family.
I have a question for you. You've played with a Cintiq before, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so the pencil for the iPad, how do you find it in comparison to a Cintiq? Like the pressure sensitivity and like the drawing capabilities of it? Because I've never actually been able to like compare them side by side.
I wish I would have known, because I would have totally given you mine for while we were hanging out together. I like Yeah, it's funny because it depends on what I have in my hand. At first, when I had the iPad and the pencil, when you're drawing just on top of the glass, I didn't like it as much. The pencil itself, the weight is outstanding. Pressure sensitivity is great. Apple worked with Procreate, or vice versa. Procreate worked with Apple very, very directly, and they made an application that has officially changed the game. And it just keeps getting better, and they're doing things with this app. I didn't know that I wanted to live stream until I live streamed. And what's cool is like, if I'm sitting by myself somewhere, I draw whatever. If I'm sitting in a crowd, my drawings for some reason are always better.
Like around people, crowd? Just have people around you.
I might be a social
coffee shop.
I don't know it. So yeah. Anyway,
just like showing off. That's good. That's good.
And then, no, I think what it is I like looking and you know, that community and just getting feedback, live feedback, and just watching how other people do things. That's why I'm always watching you drawing, and that's why I'm always okay, wait a minute. Oh, he's not talking to me. Okay.
This just in.
Yeah. I was like, what? DeMarcus Holbrook, he started messaging on Facebook, and I thought it was about the show. And I think he's actually talking to Mike Chubb right now.
On Facebook?
Yeah.
Nice.
Carlos on the show. Yeah. That's what he did. Anyway, moving on. Sorry, I thought he was asking questions, because when I'm on the show, I get text messages, I get emails, I get messages from the website, I get messages on the YouTube thing, I get Facebook messages. People are always asking questions. Anyway, so the weight of the pencil is fantastic. When you're drawing on the iPad itself with no screen protector, I didn't like it because it just felt way too slippery. But then, so if you like talk to
like the Surface Pro,
yeah, like I didn't even like Surface. I didn't like Surface Pro at all, man. For real, I don't like it. the tip for the Surface Pro was mushy. Every time I pick up a pen, it's always mushy. I don't like that. The tip itself, I think I do like Wacom better, but the weight of the pencil and the simpleness of the Apple pencil is better. But Wacom also, like, if I go and I pick up a Wacom companion and I start drawing with that makes complete sense to me. And then when I pick up an iPad and the Apple pencil, that's pretty amazing too. But what I did have to do is Dave Atzi actually pointed me in this direction. I got a screen protector, but the matte kind, so it gives just like the little bit, the littlest of tooth to the surface of the iPad. So when you're drawing, it actually does have just a tiniest bit of grip, and then it's a game changer. It's phenomenal.
Yep.
But then, you know, and then I go and I sit in front of a Wacom and I'm like, man, this thing makes complete sense. It's amazing.
Definitely worth the investment if you actually have the available money.
Right.
Mine's paid off itself multiple times over.
Yeah.
My productivity went up like, you know, sky high when I actually got mine. Yeah. I was always skeptical. Like, before I got it about 2 years ago, I did everything in Adobe Illustrator with a mouse.
Oh, I don't even.
And I got really, really fast with a mouse. I got really fast.
Poor thing.
like I could ink an entire illustration in a matter of like an hour, you know, just like Bezier curves on my bitch.
Really?
Like doing that for years on a mouse made you like made me like have like superpowers over Adobe Illustrator.
I actually went to the Microsoft store a couple of weeks ago and I played with the actual Surface, like the desktop version. Surface Studio, yeah.
Dude, that thing looks insane. I haven't been able to like actually check it out.
The computer itself is absolutely beautiful. Again, my complaint with all of this stuff, you should have some sort of Photoshop, some sort of Sketchbook Pro, something installed on these devices for you to be able to go through and actually get a feel for it. Because if you don't have any of those softwares in there, you're missing the ball. The customer base that you're trying to reach needs to know what it feels like when you're using Sketchbook Pro, Photoshop, Illustrator.
Yeah, hell, absolutely.
Even spend the $15 a machine and go get some go get Mischief. You know, and yeah. Put it on these things so people can get a good feel for it. But again, the tip for that was kind of mushy. And I just
it's the same mushiness from the other one. So you don't get that firmness to it.
Yeah.
You have to squeeze it a little bit too hard to be able to get the thick thins.
Yeah. 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 But yeah, those thick and thins come out with the Apple Pencil and Procreate. I love inking in Procreate.
I'm going to have to check that out.
You said that before.
I wonder if they'll have it.
Now, why is that though? What part of it was that you like? Was it, is it the way it flows, right? The brushes, or is it not the brushes? Is it just the pen?
It's just the way the pencil itself is super responsive. And I like to apply pressure to actually get the varied lines. And so yeah. Okay. When I'm doing that, like it's just nice. I don't have to, like with the mushy one, I feel like when I'm trying to get in there, it's hard to measure just the right pressure to put on there. I just don't do mushy tips.
I mean, I'm guessing that you can get used to it, but I mean, they're very similar in price when it comes down to what you get from Wacom. So why not just go for something that's already proven?
Right. Right.
But with the iPad, though, that's a completely different story. Because, I mean, that's literally just your tablet that you can just take anywhere and it doesn't weigh anything. Even the Companion weighs like 5-6 pounds. So it gets tiresome to carry that around once in a while.
Yeah. And you know, I love my Companion. I have one of those too. I had that for a while before I got the iPad, and now not so much. I don't carry that around as much. For no other reason than I can do the majority of my work on the iPad. And now one of the cool things that they announced with the update to Procreate is you can import Photoshop files. So I have my comic strip. Yeah.
Yep.
I have my comic strip and I have all of my templates for all the PSDs for my comic strip. And I just pick the one that I want for the week, load that up, and it's got all the layers and everything. I draw in there and then I save it out. I do have to do the text layout in Photoshop. But I just, I'm 95% of the way done by the time I have to go into Photoshop. Carillo says yes! Exclamation mark!
One so I can try that out. That sounds amazing.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's pretty cool.
I wonder if now if they just made it for Android, man.
Right.
I don't think they will.
Or at least make it so you can put it on a laptop. That way I can put it on my Companion.
But I got to think about this, though. They could, long as that new Google Pixel just keeps getting better and better, because then you can have a – you just need a device that solidifies your platform. and not new devices from everybody and their mama, right? Like,
right.
Android's still built on like a 90s era kind of platform in terms of, or a way of thinking, where Samsung has their own phones, Motorola has their own phones, all these people have their own phones. And obviously, yes, I use an iPhone, whatever, but I do think there's something with when you have a bona fide platform that you just keep iterating on that gets better. Because I think if Google did the same thing, which they can easily catch up, right, within two or three versions of where iPhone is, just because of the way technology is, now it's more enticing for, you know, publishers and software developers to be like, yo, let's bring it out on iPhone and bring it out on Google Pixel. Let's bring it out on iPhone, bring it out on Google Pixel. Instead of having to port that stuff over to all the different ice cream sandwiches, ice cream headaches, ice cream, all these other BS that's not maybe not working. Where if you got the Samsung, you know, drop and he has a Samsung, doesn't work, blows up, then like, you know, because you have two different like operating systems literally on it with two different types of bloatware, you know, that's like, it's hard to like account for that, you know. That's what I think. I think all the Google people will hate me right now, or all the Android people are probably gonna be like, that's not true.
Why don't you have anything for your stuff?
You know, I think that's the only reason. I don't know. That's my thinking. I would like it to be like that, you know. I like variety.
The more you guys talk about this Procreate, the more I just want to go try it out.
You know how I'm going to get you to go try it out? You need to look up an artist. His name is Mike Henry.
The Transis.
But if you search Mike Henry, and it'll come up right away. Look at his YouTube channel. And he is switched over to fully Procreate. When he's not at work, he just does Procreate. And he makes videos on his iPad, and he cuts them all up. He actually does time lapses and like
he'll be drawing with his kid, telling like his what his kid is like 3 years old, 4 years old, art directing him.
Yeah, it's good. That'll get you into like, oh, let me try this, because like the stuff he's pulling off with it, the final images are like, oh man. You know, they're amazing.
He just had another cool thing that happened this week. I just looked him up on YouTube. yeah, that's funny. Another cool thing that happened this week was he put out this five-part miniseries that breaks down how he makes, how he uses Procreate to make some of the images that he does, and his images are super nice, super finalized, you know, ready for print type of stuff. But again, I mean, I wonder, it'd be interesting to see him go at it with a Wacom, what do they call it now? Mobile Studio Pro.
Yeah,
it's and, just like
Photoshop
lighter, and you can connect it like a normal Cintiq, which is pretty cool.
Yeah,
I wish my version one could do that.
Me too.
Me too.
Me too.
I'm looking at his stuff right now. It looks really, really cool.
Yeah, he's pretty crazy.
Getting a little bit of echo. Who is that?
It might be Rodgun. I don't know if he might not be wearing headphones.
No, I'm not.
One of the other things, Charlie, you shared a link. You shared a link with us.
Yes, I did. Which one?
Sculpting in VR.
Yeah, I shared two links.
Yeah.
Which one you want to talk about first? That one?
You do whatever one makes you happy.
Ooh, well, all things VR make me happy. But let's start with where is that? Here we go. So you know we have our we talked about this earlier this year, and the year is quickly coming to a close. And we know from VR, right? Little VR lesson, little story time. you know, there's two types of VR that's out there right now that are that's on the market, right? That you can go out and buy. You have two big contenders. You have your Oculus guys, and you have your Vive, right? Well, the Vive, you know, is a VR headset that allows you to put sensors up in your room and move around in a certain space, right? So that allows you to be a lot more physical with VR, right? If you put two sensors up, it shoots out IR data, and now it maps out a 20 by 20, 30 by 30 box. Now you can walk through levels, and you can go and change tires and walk around stuff. It's cool, right? If you're using stuff like Tilt Brush, Tilt Brush is a really cool program where you can paint in VR and stuff like that and walk around it. Then you have you guys with Oculus. Up until now, Oculus has been basically a headset that you sit there and you experience VR. Well, Oculus finally came out with their controllers. And now that they came out with their controller, it's this really intuitive controller that like has all the makings of touch, tactile like joysticks. It's the way they the buttons. It recognizes if your fingers are pointing. It's a really cool set of peripherals that comes with the Oculus and now puts them into.
Eileen said Tilt Brush is ridiculously fun.
Right, and Tilt Brush is amazing. So now it allows artists. Let's talk about artists. There's a program that Oculus has built, and I'm pulling it up right now. And there's two programs.
Did you see it at CTN? Because they had it there.
Was it there? Oh, did you try it?
The VR sculpting?
Yeah.
I tried it at the DesignerCon when I went on Sunday. Really?
Oh, wow. Crazy.
Yeah. It was really cool. You just kind of like going at it.
So it's like ZBrush in VR, everyone. Yeah. So it's called Oculus Medium. And it's their sculpting tool, right? So they've been in beta and had a couple artists use it. And it's really cool. It's really tactile feeling. And basically, imagine being kind of having like a bird's eye view where it's kind of like right here in front of your chest, like right here when you're using it. Mm-hmm. You can sit there and push and pull and sculpt, but you can walk around it, step away from it. So like I'm thinking sculptors that want to get into this whole like digital realm, that might be a way for them to do it, you know, because, you know, maybe they don't want to sit down and pick up ZBrush, but they could sit there and pick up a very simplified, you know, use your left hand as a pointer, right hand as a pointer, point at your left hand to change your brush strokes, and just sit here and mold this digital clay. It's really interesting that Oculus is coming out with these new things. Now, they came out with that, you know, and that's really, really cool. So sculpting it around, but for all you illustrators and comic book artists and drawing types, Oculus also came out with another one. So we just talked about Tilt Brush, and Tilt Brush is basically a program where you can paint in VR. Basically, you can do different particle effects and paint. Yeah, you can paint. So basically, but the paint is a 3D. Right, the paint is a 3D stroke, though, Rygon. So it's a 3D stroke. So imagine you do a stroke in Photoshop, right? Now that like square stroke, you can walk around. It's just like a ribbon in front of you, right? If you keep doing this, it'll keep doing like, you know, curly Q ribbon, right? So you can start to build in 3D with paint strokes. So just like Carlos, if you want to draw one of your characters.
So essentially
you just layer it on top and keep like, it's like building something with like spaghetti noodles, right? That doesn't move, right? So, you know, so think about like when you first learn how to draw and everything looks real sketchy, right? Imagine if you just keep doing that, I can start to like sketch out a square, or I can do like one stroke here, one stroke here, one stroke here, one stroke here. I have my square. Now let's do three-dimensional. Pull the stroke out this way, pull the stroke out this way, connect the box.
But I'm looking at the video right now.
Look at his face. He's so smiling. He's like, yes. You know, but it's not.
Dude, it's like you're building your own set.
Right. It's not modeling. You're still
like a movie set. You're just building the paint strokes.
Exactly. So exactly what I did when I first got it at work. I was like, you know what? Skip all this like squiggly line stuff. I started building a house. Let me box myself in, right? And literally started building a house, you know? And I couldn't finish the roof because I couldn't reach it. I was like, somebody get me and put me on a chair. They're like, Charlie, you can't get up on top of this. Okay, so you're going. This is why you're gonna hold me. Let me get up on a chair. You could kind of like zoom in, but like literally it's, if you're using like a thing like the HTC Vive, you're still confined by 3D space, right? So if you can't fly in real life, you can't really get to that 3D space. And you can't really go higher than where the sensors are because you'll hit a cap. But hey, if you get on top of a stool, you'll be able to, you know, paint at that height. So cool. So Tilt Brush has been out a while. It's really cool. And Aka said, wait a minute. We need to have our own version. So now, if you're following along, everybody on chat, look up Oculus Quill.
Carrillo says Sketch Jam VR rooms. They're gonna be all the rage. Now, what's gonna be funny is when you have all these artists in here drawing and doing like collab pieces and stuff. They're gonna be smacking each other in the face with these little Halo things that they're whipping around in the.
Right. So
would you be able to do it from home and then just meet up in a virtual room and just talking. Do it like that?
Now you're thinking. I'm thinking having virtual hangouts. Everybody connecting like a video game.
Yeah. Like, I would probably be like that asshole that just like runs around and like doodles over everybody's stuff and then just disconnects. Just run around with that big paintbrush like, ha, 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 ha. Suckers.
Big old rod gun painted on the wall.
Yeah, like takes off.
That's funny. No, is this the same thing that Glenn Keane was painting with?
Yes, but he was doing I believe his was Tilt Brush. His was Tilt Brush. Uh-huh. But Oculus came out, like I said, guys, don't miss this though. Oculus came out with a new painting tool also. And it's not just a sculpting one. And I think it's called Quill, right? Q-U-I-L. Yeah. Quill? I can't find Quill. It on our little chat link, Carlos.
Oculus Quill.
I think I might have scrolled too far up because I can't find it now.
Let's see. I think I found a demo of it. I'm
linking it. Yeah, so if you go on their site, there's been some animations.
Oh, it doesn't let me put web pages.
Where? In the chat, it should.
Yeah.
I found it here. Here it is.
There you go.
Here it is. Quill. Now, Carlos, for here, let's bring it together. Remember when we were at SIGGRAPH and we looked at VR Village? Yep. In the VR Village, I met that guy that was the one of the heads over at Story Studio. So this is the other thing they've been working on when they don't do that Henry. Remember they did that Henry short? They got nominated for Emmy. Wow. So
Eileen this said, wheel actually you can thing. VR with friends right now. They just look like floating heads slash helmets.
Oh yeah, and they do like games too. So if you get into esports too, like Steam is doing it, Valve's been doing it for Dota. Like you can watch the tournaments and you just see a bunch of other floating heads, people watch it. It's like you watch a god view over the
Oh, yeah, that's so crazy. Cool.
Yeah, yeah. But this Quill thing looks really cool. I wonder how good this is compared to Tilt Brush.
This lady's going crazy with it in the link that I posted.
Also, our buddy who works at Oculus, Carlos RJ, he's been posting lately. There's this other program that came out that Oculus didn't make, but it's a graffiti program that he's been going crazy with too, which is interesting. Which is interesting also. So if you guys in the chat, we'll check that stuff out.
These guys were at CTN. I think it was Quill that was at CTN. And I went to go check them out. And they're like, yeah, sorry, dude. We're booked for the entire weekend. They were
just
giving,
to try it out?
Yeah, they're giving people 20-minute spots just to, you know, put the headset on and paint and play around and do all kinds of crazy stuff. But yeah. It was bananas. There was no time, but I mean, you're able to sit there and watch people do their little manipulations and paint and stuff. And then they had the TV right in front of them. So you're able to see what they're seeing, but they were seeing it in the goggles. They weren't, you know, they weren't looking at the TV. They were looking through the goggles. It was a little bit crazy.
Man, I really want to try this like paint thing now.
It's good.
I just have like this video running and like right next to this. dude. I wonder if you can actually take that and then get it like export it as a 3D file or something like a CAD that file and then just actually crazy. Get that molded.
That would be super cool.
Like turn that into polys in some way or another.
Did you, what was your degree in at AI?
Media arts and animation.
So all of us got the same one then.
It's the God degree that everyone should have.
Hey, yeah. I think
they started splitting it up into different other degrees and made it worse. But if you got that degree, you're perfect.
You can be a graphic designer if you are an animation student, but you can't do animation if you're a graphic design student. I mean, that's the only way that I like justified it.
Right.
Only they don't teach you enough drawing.
Like, that's at all. For sure. For sure.
And
I think one of the bad things, about going to those schools, I talk so badly about them, but I'm a supporter of school if you're the kind of person that needs school. But one of the bad things that they did is they don't necessarily push the students. They kind of give you enough and here, do this, and then as long as you're trying, they pass you.
They gave you an A for effort.
Yeah, and it wasn't always the greatest content. And Ragan, if you didn't know this, I actually was a career service advisor for a minute.
Really?
Yeah, and it was hard because those people graduating that shouldn't have been graduating, they needed a little more.
How do you tell them, right? Like, how do you tell them once they graduated, your skills are not refined enough to get a job? That's why you're getting
conversation. That conversation usually started with, and Charlie laughs when I tell this story. That conversation usually started with, "Do you want the truth or do you want me to be nice?" And then when they say, "Well, no, I want the truth," I would say, "Okay, close the door." And Charlie would come walking up the hallway. He would see my door closed and he'd start laughing because he knew someone was going to walk out with tears in their eyes. And it's not that I was trying to be mean, but I'm going to be constructive. And there was just a lot of people that had this really false sense of, I don't even want to call it entitlement because it wasn't that. Like there was a couple people that came up and told me, "Find me a job because that's your job." And I wanted to climb over my desk at them, but I'm a grown up.
I think every teacher in those type of schools, they tell their students that, you know, they're ready. They tell their students they're prepared when they're not. When these students are being a bare minimum, and then just because they got an A in the class, they assume that, "Oh man, I'm at the top of everything. I got this. I'm going to get a job right away." No, that's not the case. You got to work like twice as much as you've already put into, you know, that's all the stuff that you learn is the basics, the basics of your field. You have to take those basics and apply them to something more advanced and learn it by yourself. If you don't do that, you're going to come out with just the bare basics. And then it's going to be really tough for you. And it's really hard. And it's like trying to explain that to people that don't have that self-driven mentality just drives me insane.
Right.
Because like, I know I wouldn't have graduated if I didn't put a lot more work in than everybody else. But that was my case. You know, I didn't have that experience with art. But so like all the people that do have talent and they just don't do enough work, it makes me want to hit them. Like when I see all these students at CTN and they're amazing and then they just won't put extra work because they're lazy or they want to go play video games or they want to go out partying every week. It's like, dude, those 3-4 years that you were in school, those are the years that you're dedicating to your craft.
Right.
After those, you're never going to get that environment again. You're never going to be around so many creative people that are just hungry for it. You know, right. People that just want it so bad. Because once you start working for a studio or a design firm, all the people that work there, like, I mean, they're like a little dead inside. You know, that little tiny bit of drive that they had to get to that spot is gone.
Yeah.
Most of the time they think they've arrived, they achieved what they, you know, needed to, and then they're already at a certain level, so they don't strive for anymore. But students have that, and that's like an awesome environment to be around, and you never get that again. So you have to take advantage of that. Yeah. And then just, you know, just I just want to shake these kids' heads and just make them understand.
Right, right.
But it's so hard.
And it's I got in trouble for doing this once. I was out. I graduated with a degree in media arts and animation, but my Flash work got me attention, and so I became a Flash developer. And so I gave up on the whole 3D world because I was all in on Flash and I was making a pretty good living. And then I came back as the career service advisor, and we were going to have a conversation with some new freshmen. And I was in front of class, and you know, my boss was kind of showing me how to have this conversation, right? And she goes, oh, and you know, just to show you guys how, you know, important it is for you guys to gain some perspective, you know, this is Carlos. He's been out there. He's been a Flash guy since forever. And at this time I had started a Flash user group. So we talk about Flash programming and animation and stuff like that. And, you know, I just kept piling things on it. I was very active in the community and everything, but and so I it was my turn to talk, and I was like, hey guys, so yeah, it's gonna be fun. This is gonna be a good time, but remember, you're here to get work done, and you guys need to remember that at the end of these 2 or 4 years, whatever it was, you're going to be competing with people that are just as talented, just as motivated. And let me tell you something. You're going to be competing for jobs against me. And I have my own user group. And when I'm done here working, I'm doing more work. And I'm just like thing after thing after thing. So if you guys aren't going to put in the hard work that it takes to become successful, you might as well save your money, go be an accountant, go be a librarian, whatever it is, save yourself some money, go do that. And then, you know, we'll see you later. I mean, no, you know, no harm, no foul. And I was taken into the office to be, and I was told I was no longer allowed to say that.
Well, how many kids actually go into it thinking it's going to be an easy degree or an easy career, you know, like, oh, drawing, you know, you can just draw something and sell it. You know, that's what they do.
Just like you said in the chat, everyone is Johnny Badass until they meet Johnny Badass.
Pretty much, man. I mean, I love saying that to the like to new students, because like you were saying, they're gonna have to be going against people like you or people like me that have a lot more experience. We have, you know, the actual work ethic, and then they're gonna show up, try to like be on the same level, and they're just gonna stumble and fall, you know. And I'm not saying they shouldn't try, but if they don't put the effort forward, it's not gonna take them anywhere.
Right. What was your first gig after school?
My first gig was a video editor. And I was doing commercials for like movie theaters, you know, the ones that play before the movies. So I was doing that, and then the same guy was like telling me to make animations for him while I was on the clock. So I was animator, video editor, sound editor, and everything in between. And it was just like a big, you know, cluster of just random shit. That lasted like a year until I just got super burnt out from it. And then I just started doing freelance work, and then on and off doing work as a caricature artist. Just, you know, when I got bored of sitting in a room for 16 hours in front of a computer. Then I didn't actually get a job at a studio again until I realized that all my interaction with human beings was through a computer. Like, I think the moment that I had a relationship, I had a girlfriend on Facebook, and I broke up on Facebook without ever meeting her. And I was like,
"Oh, oh wow, you okay? Yeah."
I was like, "There's something wrong here. I need to go out and talk to human beings." So that's the reason that I decided to go get a job with other humans. Otherwise, I'd still just be, you know, working freelance from home and then just...
So now my first question is, does she live in San Diego too? And you guys...
I do. I live in San Diego.
No, where did she live?
Oh, no, she lived in like Arizona.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, because if you lived in San Diego and she lived like in La Jolla...
Oh, no. That would be insane. If I never met her, but she lived like a town over.
Yeah.
No, man. I would probably
you
like...
You don't have a car.
Oh, God, no. That'd be even worse. No, I just remember I just met them online. I don't even remember how we met up. We just kind of started talking, and then we started dating, and then dating.
I know. Like,
and then we just like got in an argument, broke up, and I was like, what the hell just happened here?
Fine, whatever. Unfriend.
Pretty much like block. You're blocked. You can't see my posts anymore.
She's yelling at you because you never do the dishes.
Yeah, at that point I was just like, I'm done. I need to actually socialize with humans. I need to. Yeah. The human interaction is a big part.
It helps.
It helps a lot. Like, it keeps you sane. Just looking at Google, YouTube, and Facebook all day while you work is not good for the human mind.
Oh, you get into some dark points, especially with
YouTube. Yeah.
You're like, where am I at? Why am I watching fights? it just starts going down that weird road where like I feel like that YouTube has a dark section, like not dark section, nothing like seedy, but like just like there's a lot of stuff on YouTube that they can't possibly like manage or control, you know what I mean? And then now since everything's more international now too, with YouTube. I start getting like, I don't even understand this person. He's speaking Spanish or some other language or whatever. Why is it on my English YouTube? Like, where is this coming from? Like, YouTube is like a force to be reckoned with.
I've been where, like my sister and I, my Chicago sister and I, we'd look up, we're about to go out and hang out with some friends, and we're like, and she'll be like, oh, you got to see this girl fight video. So then we punch up girl fight video. And then I'm like, oh no, you have to see this other one. Boom. And then you see another fight video and then another fight video. And everyone's like, where the hell are you guys? Oh, no, one more video. And all of a sudden, everyone that we're supposed to be going out with is now at the house watching girl fight videos.
It's just so bad. And you feel bad. That's why I can't, like, what's the word I was looking, the title I was looking about? Oh, like the world stars. But then now I can't look at it now, because then I start feeling sad.
Aw.
You're out here looking crazy. Every video is just over and over again. It's reminding.
I think once you start going down that path of seeing videos of people getting hurt, it just, it's just way too entertaining.
Yeah,
it's just too good. Humans just like violence. It's awesome. Yeah.
You know, I'm about the ones you don't know, the like the fail videos. Have you seen the fail videos? Not even the ones that are just like now there's like streaming fail videos where people like are starting fires on accident and they're like waste baskets and all. So just like people are just because everybody's so interconnected now and everything just gets caught on tape or people are sending people 100 pizzas to their house and like, you know. Or you get the whole swatting stuff, which is even worse, which I think is so, so like uncool. But like, it's just, like you said, we get too connected to looking at stuff through these screens that like people lose a sense of reality sometimes.
On the chat, we're talking, and Eileen is talking about, it's not that she feels like she's all that and a bag of chips. It's the complete opposite of that, where she lacks the confidence. How do you, Raghun, how do you, have you ever had that situation where you feel like maybe you're not that good?
All the time.
Yeah.
All the time. It's like, I surround myself, I've surrounded myself over the last like 5-6 years with incredibly talented artists. Because every single time that I find somebody that's better than me, it makes me want to be that much better. And I noticed that when I was younger. But I always feel inferior to all these artists. It makes me sometimes really question why, you know, people are actually liking my work. But, I mean, the other side of me kicks in, which is the business side of me. And I understand that I have to portray confidence to all my clients, or I have to pretend that I am incredibly confident, not cocky, but just really confident about my work, so that clients think that I am really good. So they think that that's the reason that they should go with me instead of, you know, somebody else. So that even when I'm confident about a project, I'll exude that confidence tenfold. But when I don't have it and I'm not completely sure I can do something but I still want to take on the project, I'll fake the hell out of it and then the gig and then just learn how to do it really quick. You know, it's part of the like it's part of the job. Like you have to be able to adapt on the spot. And but if you, for example, if you go up to a client, it's like, oh well, I don't think I'm very good at this, but I mean I might give it my best shot, they're not gonna go with you. They're just going to give it to somebody that actually, even if they're worse artists, they're going to give it to the person that thinks they're good at it. You know, it's just about faking it till you make it. That it's so tacky and everybody says that, but it's actually very true. When it comes down to talking to clients and talking to other people, if you want to get their attention and you want to get their projects and their money in your pocket, you need to make them understand that you are the shit without acting cocky. Like you still have to be humble about it, but they have to understand that you know what you're talking about and that you're going to do something amazing for them. So if they can't tell that from just talking to you, they will not go with you. They won't choose you for whatever they want to do. So, I mean, I learned to fake it whenever I need it. And I don't necessarily demonstrate that I'm not confident in what I do, but a lot of the times behind the scenes, like in here, I'm just like, holy shit. Yeah. Like I need to work a lot. Like I need, like I look at other artists and I just measure them in years that it would take me to get to that level. Like I'll look at someone like, ah, that's like 6 months. And I'll look at somebody like, ah, oh, man, that's like 10 years. oh man. Okay. And I'm like, I love you, but I hate you, but God, like it's going to take so long to get to your level.
Yeah. So true. Oh, look at that creator of Mario. Creator of Mario on how smartphones will introduce new players to Nintendo.
Smartphones.
Yeah, they're making Mario Run.
Mario Run. So it's a Mario game, basically.
So it's like Temple Run, but with Mario?
Yeah. Kind of, but it feels like more like Mario. Like, you still feel like you're going through those same type of levels. You just, it's just pushing you through, though. Because I thought it was just going to be like a straight linear, like you just jump, jump, jump. But there's one point where you're like underground. You know how you're underground on Mario, and you go back up through the pipe, you know, and come back out. He was just on Jimmy Kimmel. Check it out. Not Jimmy Kimmel. Jimmy Fallon. Hmm. Check him out. They showed that, and they showed the new Nintendo Switch, which is the new Nintendo console. Have you guys seen that yet? No. So the Switch, right? It's a console. Think of like a screen with the controllers here on the side, and it fits into a dock. So you can sit there and play it while you watch TV. When it's time for you to go and leave your house, you get on the train, you grab it, boom, take it out, and take it with you. You're still playing the same game. That's crazy. Right? And then say I'm over Carlos's house, and he wanna play a two-player. I'll set that same screen with my controller down, right? The two handles come off. I give Carlos one of the controllers, pop off the kickstand, and now we're playing both.
Like a built-in TV with a game.
Right. But it's but you're taking the game system with you. So the only thing that's at home is just like the docking mechanism that allows you to view it, you know.
See, now if they only include
that's what it is. Yeah, it's just like
your 3DS games, that'd be amazing.
That's... Somebody else said that on a Reddit thread or something.
Like, it would be just a combination of the Wii and the 3DS in one. It'd be amazing. That'd be awesome.
Yeah.
But is it even going to be a touchscreen thing?
I don't know. I don't think so. Nothing that I saw was touch yet, but I have to re-look at the specs. It's supposed to be out March of next year.
Sounds cool. I mean, it has to compete with... I don't even know if they go for the same market as the Xbox and the PlayStation anymore, though.
Yeah, they're not. They're going for that gimmick. I don't even want to call it gimmicky. They're just going for that, like...
More like family-oriented, right?
Family, definitely innovative.
A lot more casual gamer than...
Casual, innovative market, you know, because it's always some kind of gimmick. The Wii U, the ones before that, you know, the Wii Fit, all the stuff. Now you have the Switch, you know. It's an amazing product in the fact of, like, man, that's new and different, right? It's like they took a Game Gear... made it like iPad thin, about this big, you know, and then made a docking system for it, but the games still look the same quality. Like, they look nice. It's not like all like super realistic, but like even like the new Zelda that they're doing is like open world. Like, you can go anywhere. Like, if you see they say, which is
game jack a car,
right?
Stab a couple.
they're saying, like, if you see like a mountain in the background, you can get to that mountain. Just keep walking that way. That kind of big. Like, you see whatever's on the horizon, you can actually get to, which would be interesting, you know, for a Zelda game.
It's set to release in March of 2017.
Right.
And according to Eileen, she says the Switch is going to be amazing.
Eileen's gonna have one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she will.
And with that said, boom 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 boom. This or that. This or that. This or that. This or that. Rodgon, RODGON.com. This or that. Where did my this or that go? Thank you, Chuck. Since I wrote this one because of during the show we talked about this, would you rather YouTube or WorldStar?
YouTube. YouTube. I don't want to get punched in the face.
Oh, what was it? Carrillo said on here, the new WorldStar is people yelling at customer service. I voted for Trump. so good. Here we go. Cars or motorcycles?
Motorcycles every day.
Nice. Let's see. This one, I'm gonna wait for that one because that one's actually kind of funny. How about this? How about pencils or styluses?
Pencils. Nothing will beat a pencil to the paper. Nothing.
Nice, nice. How about Companion or Mobile Studio Pro?
Well, I haven't tried the Mobile Studio Pro, so I'm gonna stick to my Companion, Old Faithful.
Did you see? Well, actually, Carly actually won a Mobile Studio Pro. I think the 13 inch.
Really?
Yeah, she won the 13 incher.
Yeah. Yeah, she came in second.
She had the best weekend of her life.
Yeah.
She got to tour Nickelodeon things to me, and she got to like see all these different things, and that was the first time I ever met her.
That's crazy.
That was awesome.
They yeah, I told the story. I got the not Nickelodeon, but I got to go to Disney TV, and I was talking to the guy, and he's like, "And this is, you know, we're going to be releasing Tangled and stuff." And I was like, "Oh, hey, that's me and a friend of mine, Francis. We worked on the website for the movie Tangled movie." And he's just like, "Okay," and then just kind of walked off. I was like, "Damn it, you're supposed to give me exactly." That's exactly what I got. I got some Jiminy Crickets. Shut up, Chuck.
Okay.
Your mic sounds a little funky.
Really?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's starting to break up. Hey, Rodgon. Design or illustration?
Illustration. I like design, but dude, nothing beats just drawing characters, sceneries, everything like that. Screw logos, man. If I don't have to do a logo again in my life, I'd be more than happy.
Yeah. Ooh, you just reminded me. I have a logo project I have to get on.
That's what you got to do.
And since we're on the topic, you went to school for media arts and animation.
Yep.
Illustration or animation?
Animation. I learned to draw on my own pretty much.
Nice.
Like, nice. You take like 4 drawing classes the whole time you're at AI. Yeah. Like, I think I went back to review the curriculum with them in 2010 because they called me in as a freelancer's perspective. So it's like 2 life drawing classes, 1 anatomy class, and then a couple character design classes in 4 years. And then they expect you to actually know what you're doing. So yeah, no, I taught myself for the most part.
Yep. Okay. So sorry, I was on the chat room. Okay. So last one I have, CTN was great. Carillo says, CTN was great. I just wish I had gone into it with more confidence and planned on hanging out more.
It's definitely a networking place.
Yeah.
Like, if you don't talk to people, you're missing out on half the experience.
Yeah, that's true. And there's I met a lot of really cool people. Like if you ever watch the Wacom YouTube channel, Tech Man Joe.
Huh. Yeah.
He used to host their artist, you know, artist come play with the Wacom thing and Tech Man Joe. I was just there in the middle of the hallway. I was like, "Tech Man Joe." He goes, "What?" I'm like, "Dude, I watch you all the time." He's like, "Oh, that's incredible." And he was flattered that I recognized him. I was like, "Dude, are you serious? You're you." So we sat there talking for, you know, like maybe 15 minutes.
Nice.
Talking about Wacom products and the new stuff that's coming out. He wants to do more shows like that. Yeah. Who else? Jorge Gutierrez. I met him. He was just sitting there talking to some dude, and I was like, "I'm sorry for being absolutely rude, dude, but you're amazing, and you're super, you know, motivational. He goes, oh, cool. He sat and talked to me for a handful of minutes, and we took a selfie and all kinds of stuff. Everyone is so cool there. And then I bump into Ragon, and I was like, dude, you're you. And he's like, I know, I'm me. And I was like, no, for real, that's you.
Honestly, I was so, like, three people recognized me at the event.
Yeah.
And I was just giddy like a little schoolgirl.
Oh my God, oh my God.
I was like, oh my God, let me draw something for you. Let me, I want to pay you back in some way or another for making me feel like this. Ah, I was so excited and happy.
Yeah.
I was like an F level celebrity.
Is there another, what you call it? What would you even call CTN? Is that a conference, I guess?
I mean, it's still a convention.
Convention.
But it's not quite like Comic-Con or like, I mean, I went to the other one, Designer-Con, which was really, really cool.
Yeah. I wanted to go to that, but it was just too much. I was falling asleep on people. I was tired because I just kept waking up early and going to the different classes and stuff. And but I'm
that one was more like based on selling stuff. Imagine that whole Artist Alley, but with people actually selling things instead of having, like, you know, broke students going around buying a pin and asking for a portfolio review. Yeah, which is something that I saw a lot there.
Yeah,
I talked to a couple of the artists there too, and they were like, "Yeah, we haven't sold anything this week, but I mean, I gave like 17 portfolio reviews." I was like, "Aw, that's so sad."
All right, last this or that, last one. Ready?
Yeah.
Virtual reality,
ooh,
or virtual relationships.
I'm going to go with virtual reality because no more relationships, virtual stuff. No, not with human interactions. That, bad, bad, bad memories. No.
That's way too funny.
I just want to try that whole thing with the... now I'm like trying to find out where I can actually go demo it.
What the virtual reality thing?
Yeah, the painting one.
Yeah.
I mean, the sculpting one was really fun, but the painting one just looks awesome. That just looks like other level.
Yeah. There was another one, or imagine maybe I'm
thinking... you can record it. If you could record what you're seeing from a first person point of view as you do it.
That would be cool.
You can record
that. That would be so cool.
Oh, you can record it.
You can record it, yes.
Oh my God.
That's what God sounds like.
You know, just like Carlos and them when they do Procreate. But just imagine watching that in 3D when you watch it.
I need to stream something like that. It's like it would be like a drug addict's lucid dream. Just like
different camera angles. You can do different camera angles and stuff, and like I can step back and watch the drawing being built and walk around it. You know?
Yeah, that just sounds awesome. Oh man, is it ready? Like, is it available for public?
Yes, it is.
Whoa.
Hmm. So you can get Killbrush through Steam. So if any of you guys have Steam, do a Steam download under the Steam VR section. If you have an Oculus or a Vive,
look up how much an Oculus Rift is right now.
Well, there you go. Here we go.
Yeah, you might know.
it's the rabbit hole, buddy, because you gotta get a PC. I can help you build a PC for it. Now they got bundles though. So now they got bundles. You can find a good bundle for like $600-$800.
The headset is $600. The Oculus Rift 3 item bundle is $1,700.
Yep. Woo. For that I get a Mobile Studio Pro. Call it a day.
Yeah, just move it around.
Not quite attainable yet, right? Not quite attainable yet. Just come to Chicago and I'll bring you into work and you can try all the stuff you want.
I know, right? Hey, shoot, I'm ready to go.
Find myself over there. I'll hit you up.
Come on over.
That's awesome.
We got a whole room for you to stay in now, Carlos. We got a whole room with a couch and sunroom. It's perfect.
It's called the car.
I'm in. Yeah. We call it outside. We call it get out of my house, stranger. All right. Never. So now let's shift into artist inspiration. Oh. Artist inspiration. You're the inspiration. Jack, we miss you, kid. We need you back.
I didn't want you to try to hit that high note.
You're the inspiration. Wanna have you hear me? I'll do that. Sorry, guys. So I am going to share my screen. I should have done this instead of trying to sing. I should have shared my Rodgun, if you have anyone that you want to share as an inspiration. Otherwise we'll just show Carly's stuff.
Well, if you want to look up Genevieve Tsai, T-S-A-I.
S-A-I, you said?
T-S-A-I.
T-S-A-I.
There you go, the first one, Genevieve T-S-A-I. This girl does some ridiculous stuff. Like, her stuff just appeals to me in an incredible way. It looks like a very fine Chris Sanders, but more towards an anime, more illustrative than animation. But I don't know, the stuff that she did for League of Legends, which is a game that I'm addicted to, is just
You play League?
I play League, man.
What's your Elo?
I don't really play all that, rank that much. I think I got
you
got to
be careful
one.
With the game. When you start talking gaming, you got to be careful when Charlie's around. You can't be fake pimping and Charlie's here.
Charlie, no. I never claimed that I was a really good player. I just love the game.
Yeah. No, that's the addicting part. Okay. Because the chat's way too talked to be just doing it for nothing. But yeah, if you play with friends too, it's awesome too. Yeah, that's awesome though. You get brownie points in my book.
No, I think the highest that I ever got to was silver 3, and then I just went to so many bad games that I just demoted to bronze 1.
Yeah, I can see that. I can see that. That's people start throwing games. It's just
See, cool. This girl is the level that I want to get to within the next couple years.
Oh, really?
She does a lot of stuff for game developers and stuff like that. And I mean, that's always a realm that I've always wanted to tap into, but just seeing what she does and how she does it is really inspiring to me. So I love her stuff.
Hers? A lot. Okay, yeah. Cool. You definitely can do it, man.
Yeah, she's.
Yeah, I've seen her stuff before.
She caught my eye back with this one. Where'd it go? I think it's might be in here. The one with the four girls holding the surfboard.
Yeah, she did a book with Chris Sanders called something mermaids. I can't recall off the top of my head.
Here, let's see, because I have.
It's probably there somewhere. Here. Rescue Sirens.
Rescue Sirens. RescueSirens.com.
Yeah, her.
Pretty amazing.
If you see her thumbnails, the process that she goes through, and then the end product, that's just really, you can tell that she puts a lot of work into her stuff.
That's crazy.
There's another kid on Instagram that I really like too. I think he's under Red Pencil Entertainment.
You know, I just found him.
I've heard of him.
That guy is
awesome. Found him.
I love his work.
I just started following him on, I think, Twitter and YouTube. I shared a link with Charlie. He was one of the guys that, because you know how Jack and I were messaging back and forth about trying to find a frame-by-frame software for the iPad?
Yeah. Right, yeah.
this guy had done a review for, what was it, Rough Animation app for the iPad.
Oh, really? Is it pretty good?
Yeah, this guy is amazing. Actually, that one's mine. What was it? Red Pencil.
I'm looking it up right now. Red, like the underscore pencil _ entertainment. I think it's okay.
Let's see, Sketch Blog. Let's do that one. Yeah, this guy.
Yeah, he just has a lot of life into his drawings.
Yeah.
Randy Bishop is another one that I like a lot too.
We're gonna have to get you back on the show just to talk about people that you follow.
Oh, dude, man, rapid fire. I can speak for days. So many people that I
was pretty good at rapid firing. This dude's like, yo, this dude and this dude.
Yeah.
Most of them's like, oh, I didn't know we were gonna do this. Okay, let me find somebody real quick.
Oh man, yeah. Jerry, like the guy that was with me at CTN, that guy's my R&D man. Like that guy just knows every single artist out there. Yeah. Like he'll just come up to me one week and just be like, all right, I need you to check out these 10 artists. And I'll be like, okay, cool. He's like, yeah, these will appeal to you. These not so much, but they're really cool. And then he'll just like give me a list. And it's like, oh my God. Yeah, he's definitely the encyclopedia of artists to follow.
Red Pencil Entertainment. The artist name is Aaron Humison, Humiston, Aaron, Erin, Humiston, or Humiston, probably. Anyway, those are really good picks.
Oh, last one, the Creature Box.
Oh, Creature Box is amazing.
That's without even
Creature. Like, I mean, I was so sad that this year they didn't have their like drawing competition. The last 2 years at CTN, it was, you know, both of them going up against another artist, and then all three of them would draw like a, have like a time drawing from a theme that the people in the audience would give them. And then they would just go at it in front of everybody. And that was the best thing ever, but they removed it for this year's CTN for some reason. Yeah. But these guys, man,
these guys are amazing.
What they do with just ink, like during Inktober, their Inktobers are the best Inktobers that are out there. Like Jake Parker started it all, but these guys just made it theirs.
They brought it home.
Yeah. Like I love Jake Parker, but these guys just, man, like to me, their style is so much more appealing.
It's amazing. All right, I'm going to share mine. Mine is Elio Art. Elio Liart. ELIOLIART.
Huh, it's a very painted look.
Elio Liart.
Elio Liart.
So this is Elena and Olivia Ceballos. They are twins, apparently. They might be conjoined, because otherwise why would you have the same Instagram? No, just kidding. I'm talking smack. They have 138,000 followers.
Woo!
They caught my eye. You know,
Ellie and Ollie, apparently, from the chat.
Oh, is that right?
That Ellie and Ollie.
Oh, okay. I get it now. Thank you, Eileen. She's drawing me on the spot with the keeping us in check. So anyway,
fact checker.
I know. We have our official fact checker. Thank you. It's probably a lot like how we were talking about before, where people don't necessarily want to see the completely fully rendered thing. We like to see the looser stuff. This is what attracted me to them. Even though their work is pretty finalized, it's still very concept arty,
mm-hmm.
Very loose. these big brush strokes. I'm a big fan of the impressionists and stuff. So it kind of gives us that flavor too, where they're just like, here's a bunch of brush splashes, bam, bam, bam. This is a light side of the brush and this is a dark side of the brush. And same thing here with the character in the middle. Here's the highlights, here's the shadows. And I just really like when artists don't get bogged down with the finalizing the piece. You can see they threw down some paint and you get some really good motion out of it. You get energy out of it. You can feel what they're feeling, right? And it's not super overworked. Super. Yeah.
They have nice. A fantastic the knowledge of color and lighting is amazing.
Right. Right. And something like this, like it's perfect timing that you said that, because this piece here, if you're listening on iTunes, if you go to Instagram.com/ELIOLIART, you'll see what we're talking about. There's this piece where it looks, I'm going to assume that it's probably a princess of some sort and her horse in the middle of this just wonderfully lush forest, and the light is coming down through the trees and the shadows are very dramatic, and they're just standing, it looks like, on a big grassy cliff. Just the light falling, and you can get the what's the cloudy side of light, what's that called? Anyway,
ambience.
Is that what it is?
It's not ambient light? I don't know.
Thank you, AI, for teaching me. Actually, I took those.
Teaching all of us. Yeah.
I just really like them. I love the energy. And here's some really cool, again, not completely finished face they're looking into different face structures and face positions.
So what do they do? Do they work for a certain studio or what are they?
They look VizDev artists at DreamWorks TV. I wonder if Jack knows them. If he knows these gals and he has not talked to them about being on the show, I swear to you, we're going to come to fisticuffs. I didn't realize that they were...
Really? So yeah, Jack might know him.
Them. So yeah. Eli Art. And again, thank you, Eileen, for those girls are the definition of motivated. That's what Carrillo said. Yeah, I don't know them, but the fact that they have all of this wonderful art out there. And we come to find out, I didn't even pay attention to the fact that they were VizDev artists at DreamWorks TV. You gotta want it. You gotta stay busy working on your own stuff. And the cool thing about working on your own stuff is the more things you work on yourself, not only are you getting better, but you have more portfolio pieces. And the cool thing is, yet again, if you're working on your own stuff, you get to keep it. It's yours. It's not like you're going to go to DreamWorks TV and be like, hey, here's all this VizDev stuff that I did for your film. You get to keep it all. Right?
Right.
You do work for yourself. You get to keep it. Anyway, Charles?
Yes. I have two guys. I really only need to show two now because I had enough for both of us. I was torn with like doing a 3D one or a 2D one. So I'm going to do both because they're both good. But here, check this out. This guy's name is, he's a 3D guy. He's a 3D character artist. His name is Christopher Wright. Let's share the screen.
And I'm gonna hide this guy here so you don't see that. Hide the chat. Here we go. Ta-da! There's Carlos' wonderful face.
Oh, sorry about that.
There he is. Nope, we're good. Yeah. Why don't you tell me sorry every day? Never mind. Okay. So here it is. This dude's just so there's like an echelon of modeling that I'd love to get to one day. That is as expressive as 2D, but in a 3D format, and I think it can totally be done. I wish we had some type of news alert, but I'm gonna say this now. I want all of you guys that are listening to the sound of my voice to go out and pay money in the theaters and go see Moana,
the new Disney film. That was a beautiful movie.
Chuck, I got to see it at Disney Animation Studios.
Carlos, shut up. We'll talk about that in a second. Don't like make me to see. Now I got have to ask you, was this amazing? There, were you in like one of the viewing rooms or something?
It was, again, it was one of those, they had a like a raffle. And so if you won, you got to go to the, it was, they didn't call it a launch party, but it was like the opening party, right?
Okay.
And, yeah. And so they, it was, what was it? Maybe 500 people maybe got to go to, it was a movie theater sized crowd that got to go in. You go in and they gave you some popcorn and water, and you go in and they showed a couple of the preliminary things, like that, hey, these are the artists behind this animated short, and these are some of the artists that do this. And every time the guy literally said to us, every time we show clips and bits and pieces of this film, people always talk to us about, man, you got to tell us it's a spoiler alert and all this other stuff. So what we're going to do is spoil the entire movie, roll the film. And all of a sudden we're in the middle of Moana.
Wow. Awesome. Yeah. Cause I think that movie is the best animated film I've seen to date. It's really, good.
I think Tangled for me.
See, Tangled was phenomenal too.
Tangled was good, but Moana to me was just, I don't know.
Did I tell you guys that I worked on the website for Tangled?
No.
Nice. I heard that people that went to that screening, though, as long as you showed up, you didn't have to win the raffle. As long as you showed up, you got in. The same thing with closing the show at DreamWorks. As long as you go, you get in.
Now that you say that, everyone's going to be showing up.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. I'm going to tell you the truth. I was sitting there and some people that were going on the tours of Disney TV, they did a handful of tours. They did Nickelodeon. They did
that was for Monday, right?
They did Disney Features and Disney TV. And there's people on the Disney TV bus that didn't have a ticket. They were just there.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, oh, okay, like that. All right then.
Yeah. I only found out like after, and I was like, right.
That's the only time that I ever find out, because I always play that by the rules. I don't want to get looked at all sideways. So I'm just like, oh, okay, cool. Then, come to find out.
Yeah.
Whenever you break the rules, you always succeed. So,
dude, that 3D artist is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Sudas. Chris Wright.
Like, it's rare to find somebody that can model something that actually looks like a 2D drawing.
Right.
Or like its counterpart in 2D. And that's awesome. That's great.
So I used to work for Disney. There's a Disney video game studio, or a video game studio that was run by Disney or owned by Disney, whatever, out in Utah, that just closed this past year. But they were doing the Disney Infinite games, you know, where you have little figurines. So they were doing all the, like, you know, small versions of the actual Disney characters and stuff, you know.
That's adorable.
So they went through all type of, you know, Jack Black in there, all the different Disney stuff, but they had to, it was, you know, curated all by Disney, so it had to be to a certain aesthetic and style. Very, very hard to do, but, you know, all in this, like, super, like, childlike versions of all of them, you know, really cool, but kind of angular and stuff with it.
That is so interesting.
Mm-hmm. You know, so not only did they have to, that's why I put, you know, put game arts in such a high regard, because not only did they have to hit the appeal that Disney has to do all the time, but then they had to optimize it so that it ran in a game, you know. Mm-hmm. It still hit the same notes and the same shape language, you know, which is really cool. Let's see what else you guys got. A little right here. All right. Here's another cool one. Boom. Yeah.
Oh, man. Sean Galloway. His sculptures. Ah, Cheeks. Cheeks is awesome, by the way. That guy's, like, I remember when, like, I used to go to Borders and see him drawing on the tables and then just sit down and draw with him. And he was just, like, drawing Spider-Man and Wolverine. And then finding out that he became, like, this awesome, famous artist a couple years later, I was like,
whoa. Yeah, man.
And he's the one that did his models for him. That's awesome.
So there's that one. And then the last one. I was going to show us real, but we don't need to look as real. Where's the last thing I had? Oh, did I close it? Yep. So then we have this, I get these R's with these names I can't pronounce. Magdalena Razic, concept artist. Look at, oh.
Oh,
come on.
See what happens when you try to keep up with Rodgon, son? You need a lot more gas in the tank.
Right. So here we go. Some little matte painting mixed with 3D paint over stuff. Like, oh, designing the outfit. Yeah, that's kind of cool. But, like, this person, I don't know why I like this person's style so much, but I think, what is going on?
Oh, snap.
ArtStation today. I have to, like, reload.
ArtStation needs to pay their AOL bill.
Something, right? Having trouble keeping up under the load. That's a new one. I've never seen it do this before. That's, but yeah, you can see the art here. Look at this.
Like, nation is crushing that server right now.
Yeah, something. Look at this. This is like this warrior. Oh, this just sucks. I've never seen ArtStation do this. Here, hold on. Let me try this. Maybe it's because my Chrome is broadcasting.
That's really cool.
Yeah, it's just really cool work. Because she just has a different style than I've seen most. Or, yeah. Firefox backup. Will it work? Will it work? Yes.
Dun, dun, it's Chrome. Dun.
So the cool thing about, like, I like about hers is, like, there's, she has a little mixture of 3D art, if you guys haven't caught that in there, that she's painting over, you know.
Mm.
And, a lot of it, now it's like a matte painting style. So she's using like 3D coat and a couple other programs to paint over. And a lot of concept artists for film does this style because it produces stuff really quickly. But this,
you think it's
here,
just so they can get the perspective right away?
Right. Without, so they get the perspective there. And it's also a speed thing and some general layout and stuff. A lot of concept and matte painters are like, I would call them basically like CG artists also nowadays, because it's just, you know, you can't beat perspective, right? Especially if you, and so, if someone gets pretty good at modeling or like,
and the lighting too,
and lighting. And then when you get into some of the hard surface stuff, like you see in like the new Transformers movies or like any of the high tech movies you're seeing out, a lot of them will start even using CAD programs and stuff like that, and then bringing in Photoshop and paint over those, because, you know, intricacies and detail is what they're going for. But this stuff here was like really cool with the gold mask and all this stuff here. All this like crazy stuff down here, all these black and white grayscales of things. She just got a cool style that you don't see too often, where it's visibly different, you know,
mm-hmm.
than what
you see. Yep. So that's it. That's who I have. Cool. Miss Magdalena, concept artist at Flying Wild Hog. That's a crazy name for a studio. And Mr. Christopher Wright, badass character modeler. Check them out. Get them in your life.
Do that then.
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
Thank you, Firefox.
Right. Yeah, right. Firefox.com. All right. I think with that, my friends, we're going to go ahead and wrap this bad boy up, if that's all right. Does anyone have any questions for Rodgon? Anyone on the in the chat room? Let me check my phone real quick to make sure the hotline hasn't been ringing off the hook. Nope, hotline. Nope, we're good. All right, cool. So, Rodgon, if people are looking for you online, where can they find you?
Well, the best place to see me is Instagram, at Rodgon the Artist. You can find me online as well at rodgon.com, even though I'm redesigning the website as we speak, so it's probably not going to have much stuff in there. And yeah, I still have an old Hotmail email. So rodgon the artist@hotmail.com. I'm old school.
You get yourself a Gmail and quit playing around.
Well, no, right? I mean, I have my own domain, so I can just have an email like that. But
yeah.
I'm too attached to my Hotmail.
Holding on to what?
Man, they're rare now. They're rare. It's Outlook now.
I actually have Coconut Justice at Hotmail, but I can't.
Yeah, see.
For the I can't cool tell kids. You how. Last time I checked that, I have no idea when that.
Come on, man.
I have to go see how much penis enlargement emails I have in there.
Those the vitamins that you need.
Oh yeah, and you can also find me on YouTube under Rodgon the Artist if you want to learn how to draw stuff. And
yeah,
little tips on how to live as an artist.
I highly suggest that channel.
Good channel.
Yeah, I tell you what, I go there, I draw what you're drawing, and then I get a bunch of likes on Instagram. So
I encourage everybody to draw my stuff and get more likes.
It's awesome. And Charlie B. Williams, if people are looking for you.
If you want to find me, you can find me at cargocollective.com/Charlie B. Williams. You can find me on Pinterest at pinterest.com/CharlieBW3. Facebook.com/CharlieBW3. Twitter, CBW3. And on the gram, it's CharlieBW3.
Gram! Sounds all right, great. Kids, and I am Carlos Gomez. You can find me at carlosrgomez.com. And I, too, have been trying to figure out what to do with my – I haven't touched my site in so long. I need to do something with that. Rodgon, you're motivating me to get off my lazy butt. But if you go to carlosrgomez.com, you can find me there. And if you're on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Pinterest, or Behance, you can look under Coconut Justice. This is a Sketch Zone podcast. Go to sketch.zone/guest if you want to suggest someone, or just go to sketch.zone and you'll see, well, right now you'll see Rodgon's lovely face up there because we're streaming live there.
He's our poster child for the week.
And yeah, but if you're on Twitter, you can find us at Sketch Zone. You can go to facebook.com/thesketchzone and youtube.com/sketchzonepodcast. And when you're on YouTube, here, do that again so I can.
So I drew you.
Oh, dude, that's awesome.
Nice. That is awesome.
So then I drew Charlie too.
Awesome. Oh my God. Yes, you guys. I can't wait for it. Go to instagram.com/rodgontheartist so you can see what just transpired. It's that's awesome, dude. But if you're on YouTube, go ahead and subscribe and like and share this show. because the more people know about us, the more. Oh yeah, Carrillo. He just got done saying, if you haven't seen it yet, check out Floyd Norman's doc. I bought that on iTunes basically right when it came out. It's so good. But if you're on YouTube, subscribe and comment, and we'll be commenting back. All of that helps us reach other creative people, both to come on the show and also to learn more about everyone that's been on the show. We're here to build this community, y'all. So let's do that. With that said, y'all, I think that's it. I think it's time to call this one. What do you think?
I think so.
I think so. It's time to wrap it.
Awesome. Cool. Whoa. All right. With that, have a good week.
You okay? See you later.
He said, "Rabbit,
rabbit before you."